The warm-up is over. Both teams have to leave the area so we can make the presentation. For both teams in about 2 minutes. In 9 minutes, the match will start. You will see them against Great Britain. And before we get the two teams back on the track, then we have to present the two referees today. Referee 1, Jaroslav Malik, and referee 2, Lukas Simsak.
Game commissioner, Benjamin Weiss. Scorekeeper, Heather Williams. Timekeeper, Vivi Lethan. 40 seconds operator Camilla Bach and penalty timekeeper Mogens Jensen. Welcome. And now we got the two teams on the court. First, the team from New Zealand. And with number 1, Captain Cameron Leslie. Number 14, also Captain Cody Everson. Number 6, Hayden Barton Coates. Number 7, Maya Marshall Amai. Number 9, Gavin Ralton. Number 10, Robert Huey. Number 15, Sanavi Lefono. And with 51, Ian Simpson. Head coach for New Zealand, Gavin Ralton and Robert Huey, and coach assistant, Gregory Mitchell. And now, the team from Great Britain. Captain with number 4, Gavin Walker. Number 2, Jonathan Coggan. Number 5, Jack Smith. Number 7, Kylie Grimes. Number 8, Nicholas Cummings. Number 9, Oliver Magion. Number 10, Ayas Buta. Number 11, Kieran Flynn. Number 12, Jamie Stead. Number 13, Aaron Phipps. And with 24, Ryan Cowling. Head coach for Great Britain is Paul Shaw and coach assistant Darren Matthews. In a few moments, we'll be ready for the Nationals' anthems. And first, the Nationals' anthems for New Zealand. Nationals anthems for Great Britain.
A lot of feedback coming there. I think we're live, but good morning to you from Vejle for the 2022 Wheelchair Rugby World Championship. And we have the two teams playing off for seventh and eighth position in these World Championships. That's New Zealand and Great Britain. I'm Simon Starr from GB, and I'm joined by Dave Mengen from the USA, whose team are playing later in the final.
Yes, they are. Their final is against Australia. It's a matchup we've seen many times before.
Yep, repeat of Rio.
Could be interesting.
Certainly will be.
But obviously we're here for the Great Britain-New Zealand match, and these two teams have met before. They met early in the tournament on Wednesday. Great Britain, the victors there, 55-50, but one wrench thrown in the work here is that Cameron Leslie had a classification reduction, so they'll have a little bit different line, so this might be a different game.
Yeah, I think so. And it's taken them a little while to adjust, because that...
They don't practice that line.
They don't. And so, my money's on New Zealand to win the tip-off with Hayden Barton Coutts.
I'm not betting against them.
Against Kieran Flynn there. Lovely to see Kieran plays his rugby for Leicester Tigers, getting a starting four berth. And it's Barton Coutts, as predicted, winning the tip-off, passing to Taunafi Lefono, and then getting it back. And New Zealand with that first possession and the first try on the board. GB will, of course, have the possession arrow, and possession will be theirs at any held balls and at the start of the second quarter, or the start of the second quarter, I should say, as Kieran Flynn brings it away. His parents have been here all week, which is lovely to see, great family support. And referee Lukas Szymczak from Poland.
Interesting. Great Britain running their more balanced line as opposed to starting Aaron Phipps.
Yes. Yeah. Wow. But, a high pointer in the form of Ollie Mannion. And he's a three-point player, and he's pressurising Barton Coutts there along with Jack Smith. Now he drops off to try and... Oh, brilliant play! So, Ollie, there you saw him with his chest puffed out there as he tried to keep all his weight back after that huge hit.
And you'll notice, too, that he actually got up on the frame of his chair, but because he doesn't have the ball, that's not a violation. If he'd had the ball and your frame touches the floor, they will call you for as if you had fallen over with the ball and not called timeout.
Yes, but he made sure he didn't make contact with... Hayden Barton Coutts.
And very challenging to do so. Like he, yeah, by all rights, should have ended up in the lap of Hayden
Quite.
Barton Coutts.
So, and he forced the timeout to be used by New Zealand there. So great play by the young man who started out with Canterbury Wheelchair Rugby Club.
Also notable that if Barton Coutts had pushed through that and caused him to go over, that would have been a penalty as well, which is why he had to stop.
Yeah.
He could have backed off and waited to see what happened, gone around him possibly, but I think he was watching, hoping that he would fall into his lap.
He was.
Because that would have been a foul, and they would have had a shorthanded.
You actually saw Barton Coutts lean forward a bit to close that gap for the potential contact. So, again, very...
Not
very
egregiously, tricky. But...
No. It was very subtle, and it was very clever. There we are. We just see it again. There, look, there's that movement forward. Come to me, please.
I thought he was also protecting the ball there.
He was doing that as well, yeah.
Because in theory, he could put his hand on the ball and use that to right himself as well as try and get the held ball, as long as he doesn't make contact.
Yeah, I think he was intent on throwing all of his weight as far backwards as he possibly could. Anyway, it's Kieran Flynn once more as... GB's ball handler. That's often a role assigned to Jamie Stead when GB play these balanced lineups.
Interesting that we haven't, now four tries in, haven't heard Cameron Leslie's number called yet. Number one, he is
being marshalled by Jamie Stead and Kieran Flynn for a second there. But, Ollie again in the face of HBC, as Chris Ryan likes to refer to him.
You know, it's interesting what you said earlier that they didn't practice together. You can see that in Barton Coutts and Leslie trying to work together on that line. When Barton Coutts got in trouble, he was looking for Leslie to be available as a passing option, and he wasn't.
It's not there at the moment, no. It's, So Jack Smith also getting a starting berth, which doesn't always happen. There are times when he is in the starting four, but in Today's one of them.
The phono number 15 for New Zealand on the line, as well as number 9, Gavin Rolton.
Yeah, Gavin, one of the two New Zealand head coaches who are actually players as well. And then they have Leslie and Everson as co-captains on the team. So there's a lot of leaders in this New Zealand team.
They like leadership by committee.
I couldn't possibly say that. Nice work there by Kieran Flynn, but Lefono gets him second time around, and Gavin Rolton in with the pick.
He's doing a nice job, though, of getting the ball onto the court, and, you know, he's halfway to half court line, which means he can easily make that pass.
Arm in there from Barton Coutts, but it doesn't stop Jamie Stead. And two Polish referees here refereeing this one. There are three Polish referees in total at these World Championships, which is brilliant to see.
In trouble.
Wow, three timeouts, and we're not even halfway through the first quarter. So good early pressure from GB.
And it sounds like the line choice worked really well too for them.
Yes.
Rather than going with a high-low, go with three ball handlers.
Yeah, I've not seen this lineup from recollection.
It's been great defensively.
Yep. Looks like New Zealand might be looking to ring the changes, because as you say, it's not quite working for them. So it looks like we're going to see Gareth Lynch and Cody Everson come on. So more of a more high low than the balance of that Lefono brings as a midpoint.
Certainly. Well, I wonder if that's more about having another picking chair out there in order to stop the offense of Great Britain. Or maybe to protect Barton Coutts, because he has had no luck getting out of the backcourt.
No. Although he's scoring most of their tries. He's getting, when he does get out the backcourt, he then gets on the end of the passes. Cameron Leslie, great
play. Got his hand in there.
Yeah. Still a GB ball. And
not a foul.
No, it was a beautifully clean flip. You can see
it. I wonder how did he lean forward to try and make that change? Oh no, their chairs got connected.
Yeah. And Leslie had a little word to Ollie Mannion there.
Mannion's chair kind of got sideways, so that the tire stuck to the floor, and that kind of tossed him. Wheelchairs don't go sideways.
Unless somebody smashes you.
That's very frustrating when you're trying to change directions.
Yes.
Or at a concert and there's a mosh pit next to you. That was a scary situation. Anyway.
I can imagine. So, GB still with the ball.
Stead trying to get in there.
Yep. And Barton Coutts trying to reverse, but he can't match Stead's speed. Which I have to say very slowly there.
Most people's backward gear won't match the forward gears.
No. So Lynch with the inbound, looking for the telescopic arm there of Barton Coutts. Just uses one hand to pluck it from the sky. And Leslie takes it away. He hasn't been the one taking it over halfway that often. He's usually been in the front court waiting for a pass. He turns away from the halfway line, that danger zone. Great pick there from Cody Everson there to block Ollie Mannion.
And just still chewing him up there. He kept Mannion out for a while so that New Zealand could get in that attack.
There's an equipment timeout called.
Barton Coutts is trapped in the key.
So GB have to give him a meet. Oh, it's Cameron Leslie by the looks of things.
And smart by Leslie to stay right where he is, because when you're supposed to stay where you are when you have an equipment, and the people around you have to give a meter so that the equipment people can come, and Barton Coutts is trapped there.
Yes.
So he was able to get out of the key, not worry about that 10-second in the key call.
Yep, but talking of 10 seconds, that's how many remain on the possession clock for New Zealand. They won't want to burn their final timeout on this play. So they look to keep one in the locker. That's great work. But Smith and Stead stop Barton Coutts. But, oh, excellent work. Literally just on the buzzer there.
Smith had his hooks into the front of Barton Coutts' chair. He knew he wasn't going to get in, so he had to pass it. So far.
Oh, arms in from Barton Coutts.
Wow, got it.
Oh, twice in quick succession.
That's pretty amazing.
That's phenomenal play.
That's why you don't pass over a guy like that.
No.
You need to either pass before he's in your face or you need to pass around him.
Yeah, a low bounce pass to the side of him. Yeah. But there's the first one against Ollie Mannion. It lands in Kieran Flynn's lap, but Barton Coutts straight into his face.
Shaquille O'Neal's favorite player.
So, chair repairs for Ollie Mannion there, and GB will look to level it up. They've got 28 seconds, so they were in danger there of not getting the ball over the halfway within the 12 seconds.
But now a new 12, and with New Zealand in the key, they won't have any problem with that.
I saw the Swiss team would go into the defensive formation halfway up their own backcourt, well away from their key. They'd come out to meet them. Here we have got a steal there. Jamie Stead had his pocket picked by Cameron Leslie, and that's on to Barton Coutts. New Zealand 6-4. Great piece of play by Leslie there, the New Zealand talisman.
He knew he had the advantage, that's why he backed out. He just wanted to get across the line, and Barton Coutts caught up to him.
Yeah, smart
so
play.
Because if he'd been hit, he'd have gone flying.
Yes, when he's going backwards, the front of his chair becomes the back of his chair. So.
Even more dangerous to get hit as you're going backwards fast.
Pump pass there, very well executed by Gareth Lynch to Cameron Leslie. That's a technique of inbounding that we do see from quite a few of the low pointers. And Jack Smith there trying to get a hand in, but also a good block on Leslie for a second or two, but he finds Barton Coutts once more, and that HBC Leslie axis working particularly well for New Zealand.
Yeah, despite the having used three timeouts, they're up 7-5.
Line violation by GB. They caught the sideline.
Mannion says he called timeout, but the referee did not see it before he crossed the line. Mannion here holding before he called timeout.
You could clearly see that he was across the line before he tried to call timeout. So GB ring the changes. On come Aaron Phipps, number 13. Number 4, the captain, Gavin Walker. Number 10, Ayaz Buta. And number 7, Kylie Grimes. So GB with a total of 8.5 classification points on court.
Not getting as much time in earlier games. To see him come out early is nice. I think he's a good player, and I think he adds to GB's defense a lot.
Yep. Yeah, he works really hard, Ayaz. And he threw one fabulous pass the other night when he was on court. Literally went half the length of the court as a rugby pass. He positioned his chair sideways to the try lines and literally flicked it right across
If only he'd thrown it backward, he'd have been...
Yep, the wheelchair rugby league guys will be looking to poach him. But Leslie leaves the court there. And Lucas Szymczak, the referee, says, not going to award a penalty try in that situation. I'm going to put Cameron Leslie in the penalty box. So the score at the moment is 8-5 in New Zealand's favour. And GB will be looking to pull that one back.
As a coach, that penalty for crossing the line, you can't be upset about that. He's making aggressive defensive plays.
So Gavin Walker's put a trap on the penalty box.
He stopped the try.
Yeah, so Ayaz crossed, and Leslie is now double-teamed by Walker and Buta.
That means there are three New Zealand players to to 2 GB.
Yep. Oh. Oh! No try. Cameron Leslie not able to gather that pass that was bounced just in front of him. As a player, you must hate those balls that...
Yeah,
just,
like Lafono must... It probably couldn't decide, do I want to hit him?
Yeah.
Do I want to bounce it or do I want to hit him in the lap? And either that or he just shorted the pass.
So that means GB have the chance to cut it to just a one try game, and they do so through Aaron Phipps. Gavin Walker is trapped back on his own baseline.
That's a big mismatch, but...
Yeah, that's great work by number nine, Gavin Rolton. New Zealand back to their original starting four with Lafono. So Walker says, let me do the inbound.
Strategy didn't stop New Zealand. It was an easy try for Leslie.
Oh, Barton Coots with another... That's three, all in the same place.
We don't have blocks, do we, as a stat?
No.
Although all three he has not been able to recover, but if he keeps making those, eventually some are going to fall their way.
Blocks and picks would be an awesome stat.
We do have...
I'd love to see Cedric Nonkans.
We do have screen assists.
But that's you. They're applied to the tries that are scored, not the work that helps create the tries.
So I think it'd be hard to define what a pick was in order to call it as a stat.
Yeah.
And you'd need a separate person for offense and defense to call each of those.
Yep. So Ayaz trying to get in around the back.
Leslie did a great job diving underneath Kylie there.
Yep. Kylie has to come out of the penalty box.
Kylie Grimes.
You're only allowed to be in there for 10 seconds. Aaron Phipps drives in. Leslie puts a hand in, reaches, but that's a great pass to Ayaz
Buta. A great play by Grimes. She got underneath. She divided the key, and she kept the low pointer away from Buta and opened the corner up wide.
Oh, great pass, spin and pass in one fluid movement there from Cameron Leslie. But Aaron Phipps cuts Lafono off, but they can't stop Hayden Barton Coots. A man who's played for both the Tokyo Suns and the South Australia Sharks. Have you seen him in the US? Has he played any over there? Hayden Barton Coots.
I don't believe so.
I'm sure it'll happen at some point.
If he hasn't, he should. I think he would love the opportunity to play as often as we get to play. Although a lot of the D1 teams don't play super often. There's a lot more D2 tournaments.
Right.
And, you know, when you're playing at this level, you want to play against the best competition, so...
You do.
There's only 6 or 8 teams that can run with a New Zealand in the United States.
So, New Zealand leading it by 1 at the moment, looking to double that lead. And... also to score the last try, but good defence by GB. And Lafono getting a lot of heat there from Walker, and Phipps does a great job in getting it to Barton Coots. And now it's Leslie being pressured by Aaron Phipps, and Walker. Pass back to Lafono, that's working this very well. They're down to the try line.
Lafono had good spacing.
Yes. Leslie gets it. Wow, that's brilliant. Less than a second left on the clock. And New Zealand lead it 12-10 as we get to the end of the first quarter.
Lafono not having a great quarter. He, that bad pass, even that right there, you know, he had a pretty clear opportunity to get to the try line and couldn't make it happen, but they were able to get the try out of it.
I'm not sure whether he was trying to use up more of the clock there. He could have.
Possibly.
I could be misreading that. I did think at first, yeah, he's in a great position to score, and then suddenly he passed to Barton Coots. But that's a tremendous first quarter from New Zealand. GB will have the possession arrow at the start of the second quarter, so they'll have a chance to cut that deficit once more. But New Zealand there scoring first and last, and that's the difference between the two teams.
And interesting, too, that, you know, we saw a completely different line from GB and, you know, this new line from New Zealand coming out here. So we had a lot of mixture, a lot of different things, both teams working with lines that aren't as familiar to them.
Yeah. And
good quarter, though.
Both of these teams will be pleased to get more court time for those different lines, some of those players who perhaps haven't seen as many minutes as some of the bigger names on the rosters.
And effective lines, actually, right?
Yep.
The big difference besides the score is that New Zealand used three of their timeouts and Great Britain has used none. He tried to use one, but it resulted in a turnover because he got it too late.
It's just too late, yes. Yep, the sideline is an extra defender, as every coach will tell you.
A lot more balanced scoring by Great Britain. Five players on the list, tries. Lafono has one for New Zealand, but the rest of them are spread between Leslie and Barton Coutts.
Yeah, the stats here have been a real benefit. And as you can see on your screen there, two turnovers by GB to one by New Zealand. Very clean game so far, only the one foul. But interestingly there, pass assists from New Zealand, eight, as opposed to one to by GB. So very much a different style of scoring there. GB using the screen assist for three of their 10 tries.
Yeah, while Great Britain seems to have a player carry that ball across, but the difference between the pass assist is that the pass assist has to come without any real obstruction from the scoring of the try. So Great Britain is making passes, but the ball handler still has to work his way across, whereas you're seeing in New Zealand, those guys are, the pass is resulting in the try without additional effort.
So delighted to see Ryan Cowling making the inbound for GB. He's joined on court by Nick Cummins as well. That's their first foray into this contest. Ryan had an absolutely tremendous Paralympics in Tokyo. For me, one of the, I had three MVPs in my head. Jim Roberts, Josh Wheeler from the US, and Ryan Cowling. Ryan, for me, was the standout low point player in Tokyo. And hasn't seen quite as many minutes here, but good to see him on court. He was trying to force Lafono back over his try line there. As yeah. Jamie Stead snuck in at the corner.
Calling number 24 in white. Barton Coutts wants Leslie. Leslie cannot get out of there. Now he is. Little backspin, good job on that pass so it didn't get away from him.
Great long ball, and that's one of his major attributes. Is not that with those long arms, those long levers, he can really launch that ball half the length of the court or more.
That's why you see him set up low. It's easy. He's an easy target to hit,
yep.
And then he can throw far.
Oh, and he's got an arm in on Jamie Stead. Referee playing the advantage there and did it well to allow Nick Cummins to cross for GB. His first try, the master's graduate from Leicester University.
Barton Coutts basically went through Mannion there. And I think he lost a tire because of it. Or at least something's wrong. He's got an equipment. As does Barton Coutts. Interesting that they don't have to give each other a meter.
There was a, yes. There was an amazing hit the other day by in the France GB game. Jonathan Evenat hit Jamie Stead on one wheel, full on to the wheel on the side, and his wheel on the other side popped off.
Yeah, that's the spring being compressed, yes. On the other side.
Amazing. And Jonathan's not the biggest player by any means, but when you add speed and impetus, that
speed and trunk, so he can throw his hips into it.
Yeah. As Leslie returns that two-try advantage to New Zealand, 14-12. But as you said a little while ago, those four timeouts that GB have could, if they can take those into the game later on, that will give them control of the clock.
If used effectively, yes.
Yeah. Barton Coutts, basically playing post. He is a former wheelchair basketball player. Oh, lovely pass from Leslie there to Lafono. He took it away from his body and then flicked it round. That was a great skill. So Nick Cummins, GB's 1.5, they're only 1.5 on the roster, into his Leicester Tigers teammate, Jamie Stead. Now, New Zealand rushed back into that key defence.
Unfortunately, they didn't rush back quickly enough.
No, they didn't. Ollie Mannion goes in backwards. How many times has Mannion got on the score sheet so far? Is that three for him? Or?
It's three, yes. You know, something to watch there is when Barton Coutts gets down off or defensively into that key, Great Britain is very quick at setting up on him defensively. The transitions at this level are phenomenal.
Yes, yeah, and you're doing them before the previous try has been scored, aren't you?
Often.
Teams are looking to set up. We've got an equipment call by Leslie, I think it is. So that will be GB getting a new 40.
Officially on the board, it says equipment error. I don't know that I've ever heard it called that.
No, it's an equipment timeout.
Wow, that could have been out and in if he'd right on the line, Mannion, that replay we just saw.
Yes. But the referee's deeming that he remained within the field of play.
Yeah, I don't think he crossed. Plus, they'd called the timeout, but yeah, the equipment timeout. But he did turn away, so he was back fully on the court.
And showing great wheels there. That's super play. Now plays for the London club.
He and Barton Coutts are pretty well matched speed-wise, so if one gets out in front of the other, they're not going to catch. Be able to chase and catch up.
Mannion against Leslie, but Leslie has the upper hand on that occasion as he finds Lafono, who's getting better and better as the game wears on.
Yeah, he's getting into the right place to catch those passes. He's made a couple of passes himself. He's got 4 passing assists.
Mannion again with the ball. Gets his bounce in. We're back with a one try game, 17-16. New Zealand lead it. And New Zealand will have the possession arrow at the start of the second half.
So Mannion and Leslie working up the top there.
GB trying to force New Zealand to use their last timeout, but Leslie doing very, very well there to squeeze away from Ollie Mannion.
They did a great job getting chair position and so that he could turn it on.
We've just seen referee Malek put the ball on the floor there because he wasn't happy that GB were getting the game back underway fast enough.
Lollygagging, is that how you would term it?
I've not heard that. I have heard that phrase, but I've never known what it meant. But yeah, the referees want the game to flow and they want the teams picking that ball up and getting it back into play as fast as possible. That also enables them to blow their whistle and the legal contact can start. So they don't have to look for contact before the whistle. And Jamie Stead doing a good job there. So after Cameron Leslie scored his previous try, you could see Ollie Mannion having a word with the GB bench, and I think they might have swapped Jamie for Ollie in terms of marking Cameron Leslie. And you can just see the two of them there just coming into shot now on your left-hand side, and it's Jamie keeping Cameron Leslie out of that key
That's
defense.
That's interesting, right? He's doing that on offense. He's playing defensively against Leslie.
Yeah.
But it works. When you have 3-on-3 offensively in the key, you have an advantage. There's a lot more space to attack.
Yeah. You should see some wheelchair rugby fives games. There's no space in those games. Teams set up in a W formation,
right,
or a reverse W formation.
Well, with that level of function in fives,
yeah, it's hard.
Kind of have.
It can be hard to score.
I imagine.
But that level of function also gives you the ability to fly that ball in at all different angles and speeds.
I'm sure you see a lot more.
Yeah. It's opened up the sport to a whole new host of players, which is brilliant. And it gives the guys who play and girls who play the Paralympic version extra competition opportunities as well, which everybody wants. And talking of extra competition opportunities, there is in Paris, from the 8th to the 12th of March, a Women's Cup for wheelchair rugby. They've got their own Facebook page, Women's Cup Wheelchair Rugby, 8th to the 12th of March, right by the Eiffel Tower.
Yeah, she told us that was in the same place they did it before. It was five or 6 years ago. You can register individually or you can register an entire team. So if you're a female player and you'd like to get some time in, there's a tournament March 8th to 12th. Check it out. And again, the Facebook page, Women's Cup Wheelchair Rugby.
Yep. So there's 13 women playing at this World Championships, the most they've ever had. And
one of them on the floor right now.
Yep, Kylie Grimes. And Australia in the final with three women on their roster, and USA with two women on their roster.
USA actually had both women on the court at the same time, running a 9-point line.
Yep.
First time I've ever seen that.
In GB leagues a number of years ago now, the Brighton Buccaneers had an all-female lineup at one point, so they were allowed 10 points on court. That was just fantastic to see.
We have a rogue team that plays in the United States called the Wonder Women that's all female.
Oh, right. That's good to hear.
They're not an organized team, like they're not official team, but they play in tournaments, and it's pretty fun to watch.
Yeah, like an invitational side.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a women's exhibition match at the Quad Nations in Cardiff just recently, and there were 20 women took the court. They'd split them into four groups of five. We played fives, and each five got a quarter against another five. So that was nicely worked and great to see. And they did a workshop and
important
training
turnover
sessions
there for Great Britain.
Yeah, very much so. Their chance to level it up. But Leslie's immediately trying to get it back off Aaron Phipps, GB's 3.5. So GB able to have a 3.5, a 3, a 1.5, and Kylie Grimes is a 0.5, with that additional 0.5 that you're granted by having a female player. So 21 apiece, GB have levelled it up as number 9, Gavin Rolton, one of New Zealand's two head coaches, gets a pit stop. So 2 minutes 45 seconds remaining in the first half, and we're seeing coach's timeout being called by
it's New Zealand.
I thought it was indicated as New Zealand, yeah. But obviously the GB team can benefit from that. It's not just the team that calls it gets the timeout. Paul Shaw there in shot with his four players telling them what he wants.
So New Zealand really, the reason they called this is because of that turnover, because they were up two. And now they're even, Great Britain. Trying to make sure that doesn't keep going as a trend.
Yes. Yeah, you'll often... If you see three turnovers occur in a short period of time, you know that there's a coach's timeout coming. A lot of the coaches will never let it get to that stage.
If they're coming quickly, you need to stop it at two.
Yep. Yep. Change the momentum, maybe change lineups.
And even if you see a trend after one, if you see that your offense or your defense isn't working and there's a turnover, that'll be enough of an indicator.
So Leslie driving to the line. Aaron Phipps comes to put pressure on him, but that's a great pass to Hayden Barton Coots there. And Leslie's passing has been outstanding in this game. I can't recall one that hasn't been of really high quality. It's Aaron Phipps in very, very quick measure. levels it up at 22 apiece. 2 minutes, 19 seconds remaining. Lafono looking for Barton Coutts. And taking the return pass. That's a very straightforward try. And
that'll give him a pass assist.
Yeah, we had three GB players around Rolton and Leslie there, and that just left plenty of space for Lafono to glide into.
You need to watch out for that inbounder if nobody marks him. He can get loose.
Yeah, as he did on that occasion. And GB, oh, Aaron Phipps creating gaps that weren't even there. Super play.
Some of that's just your eyes and your head. The defense is looking at you, and if you can make them think you're going to do something different, sometimes it freezes them long enough that you can just slip through untouched, and that's exactly what happened.
Oh, ball's come up. Oh, fantastic. So Aaron Phipps picking up that loose ball as it came off the back of Barton Coutts, realised there was going to be a backcourt violation because he picked it up in the front court and couldn't stop himself from taking it into GB's backcourt, called a timeout, and saved GB from giving the ball straight back.
This is a huge play for GB, now playing for the lead.
Yep, and they've still got three timeouts. New Zealand have used all of theirs now. So that's an extra half point at least to GB as Phipps again glides through that New Zealand defense.
He's a dynamic player, Phipps.
Yep, we first saw him at London 2012.
Very quick.
He took a break and didn't play in Rio, nor did Kylie Grimes there, number seven for GB. She was doing track and field for GB.
Phipps always with that signature headband.
Yes, there's a lot of players like starting to wear headbands now.
Well, it keeps the sweat out of his eyes. Sweat, that's what that's there for.
Yeah, but it makes telling Mark Peters and Leon Jurinson apart very, very difficult.
Yes.
The two Danish players.
Well, Leon has really improved his physique over the time that he's played. He's in much, much better shape, much leaner than he was.
Earlier in his Cameron career. Leslie, great steal there on Ollie Mannion, but the ball bounced off his chair and onto the sideline. So very unlucky not being able to come up with that turnover. I don't know whether that counts as a steal or half a steal. Lafono showing great strength there as Aaron Phipps tried to force him back over his try line.
Way to get a try. Grimes yelling there. He's out.
Nick Cummins trying to cut off Lafono, but realizes he won't get there in time, so pulls out.
Smartly, so that he didn't cause a spin, potentially get a flagrant, have to be in the box for three tries.
Yeah, particularly close to, when you're close to the line, but yeah, that didn't look as if there was quite enough on that pass, did there?
No, it was a little short. Mannion able to get there, though, but Leslie's...
He did, Ollie did well there, because he came to meet the ball. He didn't wait for it to get to him.
Yes.
He realized it was...
You see that sometimes, where people will wait for a ball, and that'll cause them trouble. You have to be aggressive. Especially with a defense like this.
Coach's timeout called by Paul Shaw, but another great hand in there from Cameron Leslie. He's obviously got one eye on Grundfos player of the match, which it's very early to be thinking about that now.
But it's something we need to think about, because you need to really consider the early minutes as well as the late ones in that conversation.
Yes. Yes, We've seen players have tremendously strong fourth quarters that have gone unrewarded because we've been asked to give the player of the match award at the end of the third quarter.
Well, we want to consider their whole body of work.
I think so.
But they do have to prepare for that situation and get their graphics ready, et cetera, and find somebody in the crowd to present it.
So that wasn't a coach's timeout. It was, in fact, a player timeout used by GB. So we kind of missed that one. But at the half, it's GB having been two down at the end of the first quarter, now go into the half at one try ahead. New Zealand will have the possession arrow, so they'll have the first chance to level it up at the start of the third quarter. But that was a cracking first half.
Yeah, excellent work. And you know, the one thing we missed here at the very end of that quarter, just before the buzzer, Stead did a great job of pinning both the low pointer and the inbounder up against that line so they couldn't do anything as they went in. And, you know, that kind of play without the clock being ready to expire can really change what the offense can do. You've got two players held by one. It's a really heads-up play, and I think noteworthy.
It was, yes. Because I was concentrating on end of the quarter, I'd seen that play, but because the time ran out.
Yeah, the time expiring kind of takes the focus off of what's going on the floor.
Yes, sadly, because it was great, great work.
It didn't really matter in the grand scheme of things, but I think it's a great thing to see and look at if you go back and look at the film later.
So New Zealand having given up two turnovers there, GB with two steals. There was a three-try differential in that second period, and we saw in the first quarter New Zealand scoring first and last, and we saw GB scoring first and last in that quarter.
And that being the difference, right? You got the turnovers plus that last try.
Yep. So we've now got 8 minutes or so remaining before the start of the second half. So if you're in GB, it's still quite early in the morning, so you might be having your breakfast. You've got time for another cup of coffee before you have to go to work, or, it's Sunday, isn't it? You lose track of time at these championships.
It is Sunday.
Right. So, I'm sure there are people who are working on Sunday, but anyway, we're going to take a little break, and we hope you'll come back and join us in about 7.5 minutes.
Okay.
2 minutes per minute.
Welcome back to the second half of New Zealand versus Great Britain. The score is New Zealand 25, GB 26. GB also have three timeouts remaining, and we've seen the introduction of Jonathan Coggan, the five-time Paralympian.
As you mentioned that, I see the British flag out there. I said, yeah, go Johnny, go.
Yeah. That's great, yep. Family support.
So. Oh, that's Union Jack, is that what that is?
Yep, that is. As Cameron Leslie attacks the top of the GB key. Ball's gone long, Kieran Flynn got a hand to it. Had he left it, I think they would have got the turnover.
Yeah, New Zealand got away with one there.
But
good defense by Great Britain.
You can't risk those telescopic arms of Barton Coates.
Yeah, well,
not managing to pull it back in. So Kieran was right. I think he was right to.
Yeah,
to
when Flynn should get his hand up there, and he tried to catch it, and also direct it so that maybe one of his teammates could get to it.
Close to a hell ball there.
I'm surprised they didn't call that. He didn't have his hands on it, and the line violation. As soon as Leslie lifted up the ball. The chair pushed out there by Phipps, and that resulted in a turnover. So that play, that earlier play, actually got them in a position so that they got the ball.
They got the dividend. So Walker to Flynn and back to Walker, the Leicester Tigers combination there.
And as always, we change direction at halftime, so teams will always score toward their own bench.
Yep, that's how I always, players always come out. Which way are we playing, ref? It's towards your own bench.
27, New Zealand 25.
So, Kieran Flynn trying to match Hayden Barton Coates for pace, and not sure he's going to match him for strength without being unkind to Kieran. Barton Coates, just a huge player. And Leslie, lifting his chair out there. That's phenomenal trunk function there.
Yeah, he actually not only lifted it, but he twisted it in the air.
Yeah.
Ah, to have that kind of function.
Oh, lovely pass there from Kieran Flynn to find Aaron Phipps. And GB maintaining a two-try lead now after that turnover on New Zealand's first possession.
Barton Coates patient there.
Yeah, no panic.
Waiting for Lafono to get across.
Lafono's a qualified physio, works in neuro rehab.
So,
equipment timeout required.
Lafono very close to the meter there.
He is, isn't he?
But of course, the whistle hasn't blown, so no meter violation yet.
Doesn't exist.
And that's why he moved away.
Yep. Smart
play. He must have heard me.
Paul Kieran Flynn very at close to halfway there. Oh, the ball's gone loose. No timeout, line violation. So good pressure. That was the pressure at the halfway line, but it's an added dimension in terms of strategy and
Great pass by Lafono, great positioning by Leslie.
Yep, and New Zealand level it up at 28 apiece. So GB have got three timeouts. They've tried to use more of them, but they've never quite had the opportunity as the sideline has come too quickly for them.
Phipps caught New Zealand thinking about how they were setting up. And just zip right through there. Yeah, often when I see a team going back to the key, if I have the opportunity to attack quickly, if you can get there before they find their positions, a lot of times they'll be out of sorts. You can get through without too much trouble. Yeah, Phipps was out before he had possession. Though he's saying timeout, he didn't have possession before he crossed the line and touched the ball.
He knew he wasn't going to get that.
But, which is why he didn't argue it.
Yeah. And great pass over the top from Leslie. Finds HBC. Not to be confused with the bank of a similar name.
We could get sued for copyright infringement.
We could get sued for all kinds, I'm sure.
I'm sure I've said some things that could get me into trouble. But, you know, we're here to entertain you. Hopefully you understand that we mean no harm. I'm thoroughly impressed by all these players. I could never play at this level.
No, I could never referee at this level either. So, it's brilliant to watch. That said, you know, I've refereed the GB guys in
sure.
our
well,
Super
Quad Series. Nations, those are all level teams, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's not that you can't, it's just...
I'm loving doing this commentary role. It's a real pleasure and an honour, a privilege to be invited to
invited
to be
into
here.
York, wherever you keep your computer. I was going to say living room, but it's not like television anymore, right? Onto your laptop.
Yeah, great work there by Aaron Phipps, GB, with that slender one try lead. 5.5 minutes remaining in this third quarter. And Gavin Walker puts a block on Barton Coutts, but they can't stop Lafono getting in once more.
Barton Coutts, very patient, trying to work his way around there, but he knows he's got help coming. He just needs to wait for it and be in the position to make a good pass.
So GB setting up with a planned move. New Zealand await them with a two in, two
eyes.
Out.
Yeah, they call that the snake eyes, although they play it interestingly. They put those high pointers up against the low pointers in the corner, whereas Colombia will put, they'll use three in the key, but they'll put them really close together in the center, and then they'll spread out as the play develops.
Yeah, lots and lots of different key defense variations. As I mentioned earlier, Switzerland, very often, setting up a line of players across halfway up their own backcourt. Looking to cut teams off before they even get near the key.
Yeah, they're slowly falling back. Kind of like you would in a press, like a zone press.
Well, inbound to Jonathan Coggan there. GB's 0.5 player. He needs some help. Timeout called by Kieran Flynn there is three New Zealand players putting pressure on Johnny Coggan, but he's got great composure.
And yeah, he's good at getting the ball out of his lap, but when you have three long arms from the other team reaching in there, you need to call timeout because that's their job. Whenever you see a 0.5 with the ball, the mantra is swarm that guy. Swarm, swarm, swarm.
Leslie moved as fast then as he has moved at any other point during the game.
Because all he's trying to do is hand it to someone, but he can't hand it to someone if you're whacking at the ball.
Nope. Ayaz Buta, Jamie Stead, Kylie Grimes, Ollie Mannion, the GB lineup now.
GB still with two timeouts.
Marshall Armai on for New Zealand. And the pass there from Ayaz Buta to Jamie Stead.
Notably, GB has called two more timeouts, but the violation happened before they could actually get them. That was quite a pass. Ball, but
Jamie Stead playing Cameron Leslie, not the ball. That was...
Well done.
Cameron Leslie.
He almost got there, right?
He almost got there, yes.
Stead not even looking for the ball, just playing the player,
yeah.
Knowing that if the pass bouncing over there, if he can keep him away from the ball.
So against France yesterday, we saw Olly Mannion do a great job of keeping Seb Verdan off, away from the ball. But Olly left the court before the ball eventually did. And as a consequence, France maintained possession. And Olly found himself in the penalty box. So just the ball holding France. Up. Caused him a problem after great work.
Great tournament for France.
Yes.
You know, obviously the disappointment in their loss to Denmark and not being in the medal round, but that played so well.
Yeah, the heartache of winning your pool, beating USA and GB in the same day in the pool rounds. First time they'd ever beaten the US. First time US had ever lost a pool game. And now France find themselves playing off for fifth and sixth. It could have been playing for 7th and 8th. That's the added double jeopardy that the quarterfinals bring us. As we see...
Yes.
One of the GB players, I think it's Diaz.
Yeah.
On his
it
back.
Looked like a vertical spin to me, but... he's going backward when he's hit. You can hit him in the back when he's going backward.
Yep. That's the front. That becomes the front of his chair, so it's a legitimate hit. But there's less protection there at the back of that back of your chair.
Yes.
So far more chance of you getting hit out.
Last year in the playoffs, I watched a game where a player was going backward and someone hit the front of his chair and he went flying and there wasn't a call. And I asked about it because technically that's the back of a chair. It should be a vertical spin. And we talked about it later and the referee said, yes, I think you're right. That was the right call. But
nice piece.
At the time...
Nice piece of refereeing there from Yarik Malik. Just checking that Ayaz was still okay as he came to collect the inbound. Olly Mannion there, escaping the clutches of two New Zealanders. Oh, Leslie again, almost getting a hand in there. He's having a monster of a game.
Even though legally that's the front of your chair when you're going backward, you're still in danger there. And I think it's good that you're checking on the player and make sure he's okay.
Yeah, yeah. Like to see that.
Well, they want to make sure someone doesn't get a concussion.
Sure.
And continue to play.
On a hardwood floor, that's always a possibility.
See what he's got in his hand?
We've just seen one of the volunteers racing around, clutching the Player of the Match trophy. So it's a good reminder to us that we need to be considering who should get that award. There's any number of candidates at the moment, but there's two there in your shot. Mannion for GB and Leslie for New Zealand, both of whom have had a lot of minutes and had done some great things. There's a phenomenal inbound there by Lafono to Barton Coutts. He spins a couple of times.
Leslie very close to that line taking that pass.
Kylie Grimes with the pick, along helped by Jamie Stead, but that gives New Zealand.
Mannion bit that one hook, line, and sinker.
I think I took it as well, and I'm 15 meters away. I bought it. It was a super piece of play. As is that. A great pass from Jamie Stead to Olly Mannion. Since he's been to London, Ollie's stature in the chair when he has the ball is far more upright and heads up, and he can see what's in front of him. When he went from Canterbury to London, he'd always been a stick the ball in the lap
and head, put your head down,
and just go. And
it's amazing what just keeping your head up when you push can change about your game.
Yes, and that's why he's now in the GB team. Because
he's had a great game.
He has, yeah. Wonderful to see.
10 tries for Mannion.
10. Wow, that's awesome.
Especially in such a balanced offense.
Yes.
Well, comparatively balanced. At one time, we have 7.
We did have a high-low.
Great Britain players who have scored tries where there's still only 3 for New Zealand.
Well, oh, I has with a. a 7.20 there, and how Ayaz is 3 foot seven, and he got that ball over Barton Coutts, who's 6 foot 12. That was a fabulous pass from the little man.
Wheelchair.
Yes.
GB. I suppose you could measure his head from the floor, but
he's 3 foot seven in length. Yeah, obviously in the chair, it's
a huge
it's
play
different.
There though. Now, retried difference.
Yeah,
Great Britain in the lead over.
Coming up to that steal there, great work by GB to get some clear blue water.
Getting into possession. Clock management time here.
So this is the largest gap we've seen at any point in the game from recollection. It's Barton Coutts looks to attack the key and doesn't even register the fact that Ayaz is there trying to dispossess him.
Well, as you said, he's small, light.
Yeah, 43 kilograms around that mark, Ayaz. Probably the same weight as one of Barton Coutts' long arms that came out there yet again. That's four times he's got his arm in and four times that GB have got the bouncing ball. That's brilliant play, but he's not had the reward.
GB having to use a timeout there.
Yep. Forced close to that,
again, defense,
that sideline.
Right? Barton Coutts got in there. Mannion, knowing he was in trouble against the line, no place to pass, turned his chair. Very important there. They have turned him away so he can't see the court behind him.
Where his colleagues are. So GB have a line-out change. Phipps and Walker and Kylie Grimes alongside Jamie Stead. New Zealand with their starting four still on the court. I say still on the court. They've had a number of changes throughout the game. The one New Zealand player we haven't yet seen is Ian Simpson, number 51. He's not had a huge amount of court time during this competition. We may see him at some point in the fourth quarter as we run down towards the end of this third quarter. GB looking to score last, not leave any time on the clock for New Zealand to respond. As Phipps just keeps bouncing the ball. They're down to 11 seconds, 10 seconds, and Phipps drives towards the line, pushes Leslie away, but he's got to come back. And Walker scores it, stops at the line.
Walker did a great job. He was up there keeping Lafono away from the ball.
Long ball from Barton Coutts, but it can't find Leslie, who'd been marked well by Phipps, and Kylie Grimes had positioned herself well. So, GB leading now by 41-38, and with a timeout in their back pocket.
Phipps, they're happy with how things are going. He's bobbing his head to the music. GB should be feeling good. They really were firing on all cylinders in that quarter.
Yep, a 15-13 quarter for GB. So they've gone from a one-try lead at the half to a three-try lead at the end of the third quarter. Still plenty of work and still plenty of time for New Zealand to get back into this and make it an interesting game in the last quarter.
Six turnovers to three turnovers too, so
yep.
New Zealand having trouble with the ball.
They've come so close. Barton Coutts has had four times he's intercepted a pass close to the halfway line by GB, and four times it's not found its way to a player in black.
Yeah, when he smacks that ball down, it's just happened to be bouncing into the lap of a GB player. It's been a great quarter. And as far as the first three, Great Britain has slowly chipped their way back from the lead that New Zealand had.
Yeah, so the three turnovers to one there, giving that two-try differential
Yeah, and that's big. That's half the turnovers that New Zealand has had in that of the six in that quarter.
In that quarter, yes. And much more even on the pass assists and the screen assists in that quarter, interestingly. We've seen some quite wide variations in other quarters, but...
Four tyre punctures in New Zealand to two on Great Britain. and even on the equipment timeouts, 6-6. That includes being flipped over. So.
Right. Yes, we haven't... Have we got a fallen player stat? Or is it?
We do not have a fallen player stat.
No, that might be something that could be of interest.
I think we all know the guys that are on the floor all the time.
Yes.
A lot of times it's the people who have the most trunk function because the back of their chair is always super low. So their weight a lot of times shifts in. Sometimes it shifts backward and it's so much easier to go over backward. I saw it yesterday in the USA game where...
So New Zealand bringing the changes at the start of this fourth quarter. Cody Everson, co-captain, comes on. As does Gareth Lynch, number two. GB with the possession arrow and the chance to start this fourth quarter. So GB have Kieran Flynn ready to make the inbound. Jack Smith returns. Stead and Mannion getting more minutes under their belts as New Zealand have a tyre change requirement before the before we even get things underway. Just had 3 minutes. How did you not notice you needed a new tyre?
Oh, he might have been just sitting in one place. Sometimes you get a slow leak, somebody will hit and your tyre will deplete slowly.
Yeah.
The GB with the advantage here, taking the inbound and also the 3-try lead.
Soon to be a 4-try lead as Mannion wheels over the line.
And still with one timeout.
Yes. Again, that they'll look to take that into the very, very last possession and control the clock. Well, that's great wheels by Leslie. Oh!
That is definitely a vertical spin.
He caught him there, did he?
Well, Mannion just trying to make it hard for him to catch, but you have to be careful when a guy like that, you know, with all that trunk, he's got no back on his chair. He has nothing to lean against to save himself. And
I didn't think Ollie was...
He tapped the back.
Oh, he did. Yes, I did. Yes, great call by Jarek Malik. That's why I'm sat here commentating, and he's out there on the court refereeing. So penalty try awarded. So Mannion doesn't find himself in the.
Leslie might have leaned into that one a little bit.
I thought it was just purely his the shift in the center of gravity spinning to turn and gather that ball. I thought that was what caused him to crash to the ground. But
I'm always watching for that. I've made hits like that trying to create a turnover, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But, you know, there's always that risk of somebody getting hurt, so you got to be careful
James
in that situation.
Looking for somebody to receive the ball, and GB had good position in the New Zealand key, but they've had to come out because of the time pressure, and great defence. And the ball's to Jack Smith. Great to see him get on the score sheet. The young man from Billingham, whose injury came through playing rugby union for the local club. His dad is here as one of the union jackets in the crowd. So, GB by 4. Leslie working hard to reduce that deficit. Twists and turns.
Excellent defense there by Flynn, keeping Barton Coutts away from the try.
Barton Coutts, it is with the ball now. Jack Smith looks to stop in then Flynn, but good dummy. And in the low point is getting on the try scored. GB.
That'll be Lynch.
I think asking for an out and in there, but where you take one wheel over the try line and then come back into the field of play before your second wheel goes over the line. But Yarrick Mullick says no.
That was
try
the
is good.
That was the first try by someone other than the big three on
wow.
New Zealand.
The ball's loose. New Zealand have got a hand in.
Wow.
And they've got one of those turnovers they need back, and it'll be a two-try game. Yes!
Whoa.
Oh, Gareth Lynch becoming a scoring machine.
Two in a row.
Yeah. Yes.
And again, though.
Three low-point tries in a row.
The only other player than those big three, Lafono.
Great work by New Zealand to make this a very, very interesting last 6 minutes. Ollie Mannion showing great pace there.
Got wheels.
He has, yes. Ah, so Kieran getting his bounce in, it just caught the side of his wheel there.
And Steed actually saved that from going out of bounds. It would have been off of New Zealand. And when he put it back, it actually got turned over. But an excellent effort. I mean, obviously you want to make that, try and make that play if you can, but you got to know whose possession it would be when it goes out of bounds.
Jack Smith doing a good job getting the inbound to Jamie Stead. Jack's got very, very solid inbounding skills. Great pass on him. A good punt pass as well when required, as Jamie Stead takes it coast to coast, as they say.
Weaving through traffic.
44-42. GB lead it. Leslie and Barton Coutts looking to get them. Can he get them?
Pass
no.
too wide. Oh. Not far enough up court.
Yes. Yeah, the principle was right, but it needed to be more central. That's the pressure that you get at this. Okay, so that was called against GB. That's their first warning.
So we see the orange cone pop up on the table.
Yep.
It's nice that we have indicators like that. The only thing we can't see is whose possession arrow it is. But it doesn't matter now in the fourth.
New Zealand will have it, but there's no next quarter to come. Because even if we did go to overtime, it starts with a new tip-off.
The difference would be if there's a held ball, New Zealand will get
it.
Now, that one got a little top spin.
That was the better pass. That was the more down the centre of the court pass. And it was Barton Coots to Leslie. Coach's timeout called by Paul Shaw. Just as referee Malik had put the ball on the floor as he lost patience with GB taking their time to take the inbound.
Cameron Leslie getting a little coaching here while the rest of his team sits in the key.
Yep, Robbie Hewitt, the New Zealand two-pointer and joint head coach, telling him what he wants of his co-captain. So GB's coach timeout lasts a minute. The buzzer will go after 50 seconds. New Zealand just at the top of their key, discussing how they're going to get the next turnover and force this game toward the potential overtime. I never like to mention that word, but I will on this occasion.
We've seen a couple of those this week.
We have, some absolutely great. And the Denmark-Japan game in the pool went to overtime, and those two meet again in the bronze medal game at 13:45
local
time.
You and I will be bringing that game as well.
We will. Hope we can hear ourselves, because I suspect the crowd is going to be worth another 3 points to Denmark.
A little closer to my mouth.
Yes. So GB taking their time. Stead with a dummy pass, then finds his Leicester Tigers teammate Flynn. Flynn, who previously played for RGC 1404.
I'm sorry, what was that?
I say RGC because it's Welsh. The R stands for rugby, and my pronunciation, even though I lived 18 years in Cardiff, my pronunciation of the rest of that, the C is Cymru for Wales, but it's the G I can't get my tongue around. So it's far easier to stick with RGC. But that team draws its players from central England and also from all over Wales, more the central and northern parts of Wales. And they are often heading up our D2. But they've produced some great players over the years. They've got some great experience on there. Tony Stackhouse, former Paralympian. He's married to Bex, who's one of our referees and also a table official at 2012 as New Zealand.
Very interesting play there. So GB went for a line change. Cameron Leslie went over there and slowed them from getting in,
yep,
while New Zealand quickly inbounded and got the fast try.
So GB have gone high-low. So Aaron Phipps and Ollie Mannion, the high pointers, Jonathan Coggan and Ryan Cowling, who had such a tremendous Paralympics in Tokyo, as I mentioned earlier. Number 24, and he's put a great trap on Cameron Leslie. He's not letting him go. You can't see that at the moment as you're watching Ollie Mannion score and keep that four-try gap.
He hopped out of it, though.
He did, but he took a lot of energy.
Yeah,
he did a great job in getting out. It was a great trap to start, but he eventually got free. Oh! No spin that time. Physical advantage called because...
Again, the back of that chair, so low. Leslie reached back to catch the ball.
Yeah.
Went off balance, and I think he bounced his head off the floor.
He did.
I hope he didn't hit a picker, because that is much less forgiving than that hardwood.
It was Aaron Phipps behind him, so he's got a high point chair. So
Bill, there's a bumper on there that's made out of aircraft aluminum that is not soft. They're going to go through concussion protocol here.
They're asking whether that was a vertical spin or not. The referees are saying no. The call was physical advantage because Leslie took the ball to the floor. Yes, we've got it here. No, it doesn't look as if Aaron had even got there.
But he did hit his head on the front of Aaron's chair, and that's what the problem is for him.
I don't think he did. In fact, Aaron was doing everything he could.
Sure he was. No, I don't say Phipps did anything wrong in that situation. He's going in on that play. He tried to stop, make sure Leslie's okay. He looks okay.
Coach's timeout called by Greg Mitchell.
Yeah, I'd like to get another look at that, see if he what he hit. But you know, as long as he's okay, that's what really matters.
Yes. Yeah, safety, absolutely paramount in this sport. And so we see the referee saying, I'm reversing that call. Derek Malik putting his palm to his chest, saying, we're changing that.
He did get it out of his lap before he hit the ground.
Right.
So.
Yep. So the ball was free and could have been played,
right,
but they stopped it for safety reasons.
Of the equipment, because he was upside down and because he looked like he might be injured.
Yeah, and they've... after the referee says, I'm reversing the call, the team gets a new 40 seconds.
Well, it doesn't look like the shot clock reset to 40. It's 20.
No, it should have been at 40 because they thought it was a GB ball anyway, so it would have reset to 40 for that. So, the upshot is New Zealand score it and cut the deficit to 3, but they've only got 3.5 minutes or so in which to turn over GB.
Mannion timeout.
Yeah.
Well, there goes that last timeout they were hoping to hang on to the end, but a well-used timeout. As long as you're saving yourself from a turnover, you can use that whenever you need to. It'd be nice to have them, but...
So Aaron Phipps was reasonably close to Ollie there, but he wasn't going to risk trying to get a pass to him with Cameron Leslie between him and Phipps.
Who can not only reach high, but he can get up on one wheel and get even higher. And you don't know exactly how long that reaches unless the guy puts his hand up in advance and tells you how high you have to throw the ball.
Yep. And Leslie, as we've seen throughout this game, has been absolutely phenomenal at pinching balls from the GB players. Not always got the reward he's deserved, but he's had an outstanding game. As Ryan Cowling does a tremendous job on Lofono there to secure the corner for Phipps.
With the pressure of Barton Coutts trying to push as well to move him back. and close up that hole. Leslie tosses it up to nobody. I guess Lafono was his target, but...
Good work there. Ryan Cowling looked at the ball, thought, shall I catch this? But he then saw that Mannion was close by.
Cowling kept him off the ball.
Yes.
Cowling made that play.
So, GB surrounded. Ball's got running loose. It's in there. Ball's still around like a fibber. Ollie Mannion comes up with it. It was like a pinball in there. And neither team have got a timeout. Oh, ball's been stolen again by Barton Coutts. So, New Zealand with the chance to cut the deficit as we approach the 2-minute mark. Barton Coutts there, crossing. So, the deficit, 3. 49-46, GB lead it.
Mannion with the try. He's been phenomenal today.
He has. Yeah, he's had a great game. Don't think I've seen him play as many minutes as he has today, and he was certainly he's been in our thoughts along with several others on the player of the match.
Yeah, it shows why the coach had confidence to put him in this situation rather than starting Phipps. Really played well.
Yes. As Leslie crosses for New Zealand, GB have got the 50 up. New Zealand with 47 and just under 90 seconds remaining in this fourth quarter for the 7th and 8th placement positions in this World Championships in Vejle. Parasport Denmark, Sport Event Denmark, and World Wheelchair Rugby alongside the city of Vejle done a brilliant job in bringing you these World Championships.
Yeah, the organizations that sponsor this and have supported this event have been phenomenal.
The volunteers as well have really helped make this tournament. There's an absolute army of them. Barton Coutts flicking that ball back in. Leslie's going to try and chase it down. Phipps is trying to get the chips hits the chair.
Over.
Spinning foul. No, not a. I thought he was saying leaving the court. I thought he was showing a spin there. But he deemed that Aaron Phipps hit him in front of the axle. So an amazing hit there by Aaron Phipps, and Leslie once more finding himself on the floor.
What an effort, though. I mean, he really put himself on the line in this game.
Yeah, that would have been a tremendous
situation. Still reaching for it there after taking that hit.
Phipps turning away dispassionately.
And I thought that maybe he was hurt, but he was more disappointed that he wasn't able to make that play.
So it's Ryan Cowling, the former serviceman. The GB plays for the West Coast Crash. With the inbound, as we've got just over a minute left. Mannion caught now by... he's got no timeouts remaining. He's looking for Phipps. Oh, ball stolen by Leslie once more. And it's Rolton who pops it back to Leslie and New Zealand.
With 51 seconds, opportunity to get one back here.
Oh, the ball's loose again. Good
Mannion
work,
got his hand in there and fouled. New Zealand needs to score quickly here, and the other thing they need to do is make sure that Mannion can't get out on top and get a long pass from Phipps.
Rolton's already making his way to the penalty box, but he's turned away now. So Ryan Cowling locking up Leslie, but Lafono just waiting a second or two. He hasn't got that time luxury. But he's trying to get position.
He was
position.
Waiting for the defense to get set up.
Get the transition. And Ollie Mannion will be the inbounder. So Ryan Cowling makes his way back onto court.
So quadruple teaming. Phipps leaves the give and go.
Yeah, Mannion. He's got Jonathan Coggan down court, but Mannion with a good pass, and Phipps had managed to free himself and will take it to the top of the key and just rolls it in. GB lead it by 4, under 19 seconds remaining in this game to determine the 7th and 8th positions here at these World Championships.
So Great Britain won the first matchup between these two by five. If New Zealand can score here, they'll bring that to three. Of course, GB has another possession, but the defense going to work here, try and get another turnover.
Yeah, just 7 seconds remaining. Ball's into Mannion. They don't even have to get over halfway. Can just sit on it, but they're not. They're looking to score. No try. Aaron Phipps denied at the last.
And that'll be our final, 50-49.
Yep, GB win it, but a brilliant contest there with the New Zealanders, the Wheel Blacks, as they're known, putting in a tremendous performance, and they'll finish eighth, as they did in Tokyo. GB finishing seventh, whereas they managed to win the gold in Tokyo, so a big change in their fortunes. But, New Zealand consistent in their performances, but they're closing that gap. I think people said at the start of this tournament, you know, we've got seven teams really competitive.
Yep.
I think we've now definitely got eight, maybe now nine, with Colombia beating Germany.
Colombia had three excellent quarters against Denmark.
Yes, and we've got the children of John Corson and Cherie Harris. I think they're presenting Cameron Leslie with his Grundfos Player of the Match game. Proud father John Corson, who's here in an official capacity, taking photos and videos of that moment. And the children are super happy, having made that award, and it's great to see New Zealand taking something from this game. They contributed massively to a great contest between the two sides. And that'll be it for these two teams. Next game up here will be Canada versus France, playing for fifth and sixth at 11:30. They met for fifth and sixth in Tokyo as well. Denmark and Japan playing for bronze at 13:45. And the final between Australia and USA, the repeat of Rio, at 4 o'clock local time, 1600 hours. So just looking at those full-time statistics, New Zealand with 28 pass assists to GB's 13. GB with 14 screen assists to New Zealand's 3, 9 turnovers given up by New Zealand, and 6 by GB. A very clean game.